Okay, cool. All right. Hey, everybody. My name is Kayla. My pronouns are she, her, and I am a front end instructor at Turing. I've probably met most of you, but I'll be moderating this discussion, and Dan and Judson will really be our experts and the ones sharing their experiences. And I am recording. I know there were like several events going on at once in the Turing community right now. And so if you know folks who wanted to be here and are attending a different event instead or weren't able to make it, just let them know that it is recorded. I'll be sharing that recording out after this session. But yeah, I'll be asking questions and I'm hoping that the participants that y'all ask questions as well. Two places that you can ask questions is the chat. I'll be watching that. So if you have a question, just throw it in the chat. I'll make sure that it gets thrown into the discussion, or feel free to just like click that raise your hand. And if you want to ask that question out loud, that's perfectly fine as well. A lot of my questions are coming from the Eventbrite signup. So when you registered for this event, it asked you if you had any specific questions. I went ahead and grabbed all of those. And so some of the questions that I'll be peppering in here are yours already from the registration. But that's enough from me for now. Dan and Judson, I want to give you a chance to introduce yourselves. So I'm going to drop in the chat right now. It's like, I feel like a lot of things to keep track of when you're introducing yourself at first. So name, pronouns, program and cohort, and then what you did prior to Turing and what you do now. And so Dan, I'll have you go first.
Yeah, sure. Thanks. Can everyone hear me okay? Yeah. Okay, great. So my name's Dan Phillips, or Daniel's fine. Pronouns are he, him. I was in 1706. So I was in the back end program and I finished like December, I believe, of 2017. And prior to Turing, I was a teacher. So I was an English and writing teacher for about 4 years. What I do now is mostly systems engineering. I worked as like a Ruby developer for about 3 years right out of Turing. And I did a lot of Ruby, Rails, Vue.js. So I did like full stack stuff also. And then I kind of moved more into the infrastructure side, doing more like infrastructure, DevOps, things with containers, Kubernetes, like managing like how, you know, programs run for the company that I was working with, mostly Rails apps, but also some legacy apps. And then I transitioned to doing more systems level stuff. So now I do a lot of work with Rust and Golang, and also right now C and C++, which is like newish for me. And that's more like software infrastructure. And I work for a software infrastructure startup doing that kind of stuff. And I've been there for about a year. And I guess as far as contract work, I've also when I was at my last job, I did a consulting business on the side too, which is, I guess, more of what we're going to talk about today. So.
Awesome. Thank you. Judson.
Yep, for sure. Judson Stevens, pronouns are he, him. I was part of 1803 backends. I actually only went through 3 mods of Turing. I was lucky enough to physically run into someone who ended up referring me to a job, and landed a job about halfway through Turing, with my first company. So, spent 3 mods at Turing, but, prior to that, I did quite a few different things. I was in the construction industry where I all the way from framing houses, residential construction, to owning a construction company with 30 or 40 contract employees, building houses and doing light commercial and stuff like that for a while. I was in the military, did a couple deployments with the Marine Corps, in the infantry, and did a couple other things. My classic education is a degree in nanosystems engineering, but never really did too much actual engineering, material science, that type of stuff. So. Went to Turing, and then after that, first job was actually with a company that's been reaching out to Turing recently, which is good because I told them to do it the entire time I was there and they just never did, with Fast Enterprises. So it's kind of like a non-traditional it's not really a web development position there, but it was more like back-end focused. I did a lot of DBA work, so a lot of database administration, so a lot of infrastructure stuff, mostly on Windows machines. So got real familiar with like self-hosting. Most of our clients were in the government, so we did a lot of like on-prem type of stuff. So a lot of infrastructure work there. And then second company was a company called Reboot Motion, which actually has a couple of Turing alums at right now as well that I hired. So I'm trying to spread the love a little bit, but that company does 3D motion capture data analysis for Major League Baseball and the NFL and the NBA. So basically taking like 3D motion capture data, running it through a processing pipeline and determining like biomechanics reports off the other end to try to help players perform better in whatever task they're doing. There I launched a couple products that I'm pretty proud of, including like a monocular motion capture processing pipeline to allow like an iPhone video and turn it into 3D motion capture data. So there I got a bunch into machine learning and computer vision and all of the hot topics of the day nowadays, especially with generative AI. And then current company is much more boring in the fintech space. It's a SaaS company that does expense management, but there I am a director of engineering. So I have quite a few direct reports underneath me. And so kind of do a lot of strategic work, but also just because the company is fairly small, get my hands in code a ton. And so throughout all that kind of full stack, like I said, machine learning, I do some machine learning stuff here as well on predictive works and stuff. So I've been with the current company TeamPay for about a year or so far.
It sounds like you both have had like decades of work experience and you're like, I
graduated in a very short time.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Like 6 years ago, 5 years ago. It's really, yeah, that's awesome. Cool. Great. So, you know, the topic of this panel is really focused on like the self-employment contract space. And so yep. That's where a lot of our questions will go, but I definitely think there are things to learn from all of your experience. So definitely don't feel like you have to like keep your answers contained. Yep. But I'd love to just like start with a general, like, how did you get started in that self-employment contract workspace? What did that look like? And we'll get into like way more specific questions, but yeah, how did you get started is where I'll start. And Dan, I'll have you go first.
Yeah, sure. So I started doing contract work my first year of working as a software developer after Turing. I actually kind of, it's interesting, like similar to Judson, I actually was lucky enough to land the job that I had after Turing when I was in Mod 3, and I worked it out with them so that I could start right as soon as Mod 4 finished. And so like the Monday after I started, which I should have totally taken a break. I do not recommend that. So I was like at this job for a while, things were moving kind of slowly, and I kind of got it in my head, like, you know, I've got this like skill set and like I have some extra time. Like the job itself was like, actually there was some bureaucracy. Sometimes it was hard to even like have stuff to do in certain places, like at certain times. So I just played around with the idea of doing some contract work on the side, and it kind of snowballed from there. I started just looking around on like Reddit for people who needed like freelance Rails work. And I actually set up like a little cron job that would just like scrape it every day and then look for keywords like Ruby Rails Vue. And then it would just ping me if anything happened. And I set up a little like Slack bot too, which is like really easy, right? With like a webhook. And I got a little notification for it, and I reached out to this small company that was doing work with Amazon sellers and Shopify merchants, where they were doing this guy had learned Ruby by himself and then made a platform for basically syncing up like products between like if you had a store on Amazon and if you had a store on Shopify. And it was kind of an unsolved problem and actually a relatively complex one because it involved like a ton of integrations. And he like wasn't a developer. He like was totally self-taught, and he just like needed, he was like a bootstrapped business and he just needed someone to help him out. So I called him up, talked to him. And then I started working for him on the side. And I probably did about 15 or 20 hours, maybe between 10 and 20 hours a week for the better part of a year. It was a really interesting experience because I was also doing Rails work. I was making some extra money, which, you know, I started my first job right around like 70K or so. But then, you know, I saw people in my cohort starting at like 90 and stuff. And I was like, well, maybe I can like make some on the side. And I'm really glad that I did that too, because like, I didn't have a lot else going on at the time out like in my personal life. So it was great to kind of like get this more like sort of supplemental experience. And that was kind of the beginning of it. And then with that experience, I actually kind of set up the rest of the sort of business infrastructure around it, which I guess I can touch on in a later question, but that involved actually setting up an LLC and getting some other, getting business insurance and a whole process for invoicing and stuff. But that's kind of how I got started. It was just really just from kind of like boredom and seeing what was out there. And then from there, I probably had like four or five more contracts over like throughout the following years. But I'd be happy to get into the details, maybe with the next round of questions.
Awesome. Yeah, my favorite question that was put in the event registration was just taxes with like 700 exclamation marks.
Yes.
So yeah, we can get into all the fun stuff for sure. Judson, how'd you get started?
Yeah, I didn't mention it in the intro, but so my contract experience, I had a ton of contract experience previously, obviously in other industries. One of the ones I actually didn't mention, I was in the bar industry as well in Baton Rouge. I owned a bar in Baton Rouge just for a short while, a partner and I invested in a bar. And so, you know, had a lot of experience in starting the LLCs and business insurance and taxes and like all the things, paying employees even and that type of stuff. So was luckily able to leverage that. But I actually landed my first contracting gig through Turing. It was actually one of the previous instructors there had a contact with a doctor at the University of Alabama at Birmingham School of Medicine. She's actually the head of school of medicine there. And she was looking for someone to do like a custom web app for a particular study they were implementing around sickle cell disease. And so reached out to that instructor, and that instructor reached out in the Slack and was just asking for folks. And so it was me and I think three other folks ended up kind of coming to banding together and you know, presenting a proposal and pricing and all that stuff for this person, this doctor, to develop a web app. And just through various scenarios and things that are too long to get into here, by the time the dust settled and we'd actually started work, it was just me. So I ended up doing the whole thing myself, and it was a front end, back end, basically like an appointment keeping add-on to an EHR system to allow them to track a certain type of appointment for a certain patient segment, which was children with sickle cell disease. And so I kind of got involved with her, and that actually was super successful. And we just wrote a paper and presented it at the American Society for Hematology recently, and got my first official. I had a couple in college, but my first official like byline in a paper out in the journal. So pretty cool. Anyway, that was the first big gig that I had, and I've probably done probably five or six like kind of smaller ones. You know, very lucky that happened to me. Like I've stuck with that doctor actually for these last 4 years. And so some of the other stuff that I do, I'm a part of on the board of two nonprofits, one for veterans that are transitioning into the tech industry, and then one for called the National Alliance of Sickle Cell Centers. And so it's with this doctor, she's the president, and I run all their technology and help them with, you know, various problems and tasks and things like that. So that's a volunteer. I don't contract for that, although I do get occasionally paid for some of the website stuff that I do. But yeah, just kind of a varied set of experience in the contracting arena. And it was really kind of by chance, but, you know, was a great thing to have. I also, similar to Dan, had a little bit more free time. I have a 2-year-old now, so not quite as much free time, but had a little more free time when I got started. And so it was a way for me to like keep my skills sharp, because that, like I mentioned before, I was at Fast Enterprises. I wasn't doing web development. So I was doing a lot of stuff on my own, like side projects and stuff. But, you know, it's always nice to be able to do that and get paid. So that was a good option for me to dive into.
Awesome. Thank you both so much. One of the things that we hear from our grads, and I think right now, many of the people that are on this call do not currently have full-time jobs or like part-time jobs in the industry. How do you both feel about like using kind of this space of looking for contract work as a way into the industry? Does it feel like a reasonable thing for our grads to be able to do without having any prior like actual work experience in this industry? And I'll let that be open for either of you.
Do you want to answer that first, Judson?
Yeah, sure. I can take a shot at it. Yeah. I mean, I have done quite a bit of one of the other things that I do as well is I try to, you know, give back to the Turing community and mentor folks. And so I've worked with, you know, I don't know, triple digits at this point, folks like getting into the industry and looking for their first job and stuff like that. So I feel like hopefully I'm coming from a perspective of, you know, still anecdotal experience, but a decent amount of experience. And so I think it's hard to say like, oh, this should be your primary focus because that's how you're going to get into the industry. Because let's just be completely clear. Like, it's not easy to land a contracting gig with no real work experience, right, in the industry, right? Like, I'd be interested to hear more about Dan's like kind of first experience, but you know, actually how he convinced the person to like let him help out or whatever. But in my case, right, I think it was a lot of like just presenting a strong front, but also having a, you know, connection beyond just someone looking for someone to do the work, right? Because I mean, think about it. You've got $20,000, you want to get this web app built, and you're looking at the candidates you have in front of you, and you have somebody who has like literally zero work experience, maybe has a portfolio or whatever, and then you can go to Fiverr or wherever else and get, you know, developers, maybe even the US, but Latin America, wherever, that have, you know, 50 successful delivered projects, right? I mean, it's a hard hill to climb, but I think it's absolutely worth at least looking into. And especially if you have the network for it, I think that's where the big piece is. And so I don't think it's something you completely discount. You should acknowledge what the lift there is, the potential lift there is. But if you do have connections or you do have a free time or whatever the case may be to kind of get out there and make offers to folks and, you know, talk with folks and plan or whatever, like, I think it can absolutely like rocket you into the industry, because there is no place you will get more experience than building something for someone else with like a very, like you are daily meeting with or weekly meeting with a literal customer, right? Like, you're going to go work at a job potentially where you might talk to a customer for a year. And here you're like, you know, on a very regular basis talking to these customers, and that experience cannot be beat. So, you know, I don't think it's something you should just not do, but just, you know, we should all acknowledge like how tough it is, right?
That's, yeah, exactly. I was going to say, the question about if it's a good way to like get a foot in the door in the industry, I would say like it could be, but it really does depend. Like with what Judson was talking about, like if you're going to get a contract gig based on experience, like with my first one, I was probably about like 8 months into my first job. So, and I'd been to Turing, but really like, that was more like with me getting this first gig was more of just a function of like talking to the guy and being, and like we kind of were able to, you know, like we kind of clicked and got along, and then he told me about his problems. And then I talked to him about how we could approach that in Rails. And it was kind of turned into like a de facto interview where he was like, oh, this guy could actually help me out. And he had some experience actually with offshore developers in India and South America. And both of those experiences for him were pretty bad. And he had like wasted, people typically do that because you can get labor at a cheaper price. But then there's a whole bunch of sort of intangible problems that can come up, like communication issues, cultural issues, where in terms of getting work done and expectations, or you know, even like work, like there's like middlemen involved sometimes with contracting organizations. And anyway, he wanted to find someone who was in the US and who he could like work with. And so it was a really, it was kind of luck, right? It was like, it was more just like, kind of like with getting your first job in general, it's like you have this sort of surface area of luck that you're trying to expand and then like find the opportunities as they come up, right? And I will say that like, if it's your first job, like most of the contract work that I've done, I've been like the sole technical person or maybe one of two technical people on the project. And, you know, the challenge there is like, you could be responsible for everything. They're like, oh, we need a Rails developer, but then they don't really even know the vocabulary to tell you that you also have to be the one who's going to be deploying the thing and monitoring the thing and dealing with all the infrastructure and then understanding things like database backups. So in some cases it's like baptism by fire, sort of like you get thrown in the deep end. At its worst, one of the problems is that like, some of these bootstrap companies, and like I did a lot of work with smaller bootstrap companies because maybe they were willing to take a bet on my lack of experience if we could develop a rapport and we could work together well. And they didn't have to pay some like local, you know, agency like three times as much for like the same, you know, kind of work. But you're also like, compared to like maybe their customer support people, if it's like a SaaS, or compared to their social media people or like whatever, you cost way more as a software developer. And you're very close to the business itself, right? So you, when you work on something that takes 2 weeks, and if you find out halfway through that it's gonna take 4 weeks, right? They just see like dollars, like cash lighting on fire, right? Because they see you in their spreadsheet getting paid 4-6 times as much as their next highest paid employee. And like, you really have to be on your, you have to stick to your guns and be on your game with how you approach the work. And that actually really evolved for me over the course of the contracting that I did for like the last 5 years, because I learned about how to structure deals and do upfront work and costs in a different way that was more beneficial to both parties. Because like, you know, with bootstrap businesses, it's not like venture capital money. It's like their money that they've made from a business that they barely got started and got working. So I guess what I'm saying is, if you have the right relationships and a good network, and someone offers you some part-time work and they're like, we could pay you something and we could do this, and you know the person and you're pretty confident that you can do it, I would say like, yes, definitely. Because if you, like Jeff talks about this a lot, I'm pretty sure, like, or he used to, like about like, if you show on your resume that you've gotten paid to write code, that's a foot in the door. Doesn't matter if you got paid $3, you know what I mean? Like, that is going to help you a lot. And it's also a really valuable experience. That being said, when you are doing work for like a small business, like they really need that to be done correctly and well. And so like, sometimes it can be, you may bite off more than you can chew, which if you went to Turing, like you might be used to that, right? Like in terms of like dealing with workloads and stuff. So I would say that it definitely could be, but you know, I wouldn't say that it may even not even be the best way to get into the industry, but it's definitely an option for sure. But with caveats.
Awesome. Judson, I heard you mention something called Fiverr. Can you talk about what that is? And I think like, if there are any other tools, I know so far we've mentioned like obviously our network, like people that we know, we've mentioned Reddit as a spot to go. Do we know any other places where folks can go to try to look for this work?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have any, honestly, beyond all the ones we've talked about so far, any like names for you, anything like that. But I mean, just a little bit of Googling will be able to give you a pretty good laundry list of things. I will say, though, my personal opinion, as is everything I'm going to say, so I'll just get that out, I guess. My personal opinion, though, is like, it's not really worth it a lot of times to get on sites like Fiverr or Upwork or whatever the case may be, just because the competition is so fierce, because it's a worldwide market. And so you're going to see developers promising to do things, you know, that in order to survive, you would need to charge $100 an hour or whatever the case may be. And they're going to do it for 20, you know, because 20 may be a decent amount of money in Kenya. Right. And so like, it's a really competitive thing. And so if you're going in there with no background, like a small portfolio, but never having written code for money, like Dan was saying earlier, like it's just going to be really tough. And, you know, I would say in almost all instances, your time is better spent somewhere else, right? And so like, I like the question in the chat, like around, you know, local businesses and stuff like that, because yeah, I mean, like, again, to Dan's point, because it's probably the best point we'll make this entire thing, is like, once you get paid to write some code, whether it's $5 or $50 or $5,000, like you put it on your resume, you can talk about it, you can talk around it. You obviously don't have to convey like what you got paid, just the fact that you did and you had a relationship with a customer and all that, like that's a huge first step. And so the like local business aspect, you know, that's harder nowadays with like Squarespace and Wix and like all that stuff. But like, you know, there's some like medium-sized, I don't know, landscaping company that's got some folks out in the field that doesn't like the mobile interface for something and wants something a little more responsive or blah, blah, blah. You know, like there's ways potentially to find your way if you're in a, you know, place that has those type of businesses. And I think that's always a good option, because getting in front of someone in person is, you know, a much easier conversation than trying to like, one, even make the first connection, and then two, convince them over the internet that you're going to like, you know, perform and know what you're doing and blah, blah, blah. So, you know, I not really answer your questions. So sorry, to be honest, but like, of like, where's the list of sites we can, you know, use, but I just would, you know, caution on the like larger sites, just because the competition so fierce that, you know, it's hard for me to imagine where that really pays off, where you just, you know, blindly land a great gig that like kicks off your career. It's going to be, what, one thing I will say, if I can ramble for a second longer, is I've always found the you know, obviously, like we talked about our, you know, individual networks, like friends and stuff like that. Like one of some of the places where I've made the largest strides and like worked on really cool projects has just been a combination of expertise. And so like I know a couple of people that are in chemistry, for example, and like had a friend in a water analysis lab that was talking about some machine learning stuff that they were super interested in, but didn't have the technical know-how to kind of implement. And like we did a quick little side project type of deal that, you know, got them some ups there. I didn't actually get paid for that, but that was like, you know, it just builds your confidence level. You build something that's literally someone is using in real life for a purpose, right? That's not just a kind of side project or whatever. And so those types of intersections to me are always amazing. And so like, if you have people that are experts in their field, but don't have the technical know-how, it's a lot of times those, even the billion-dollar ideas come from someone saying, man, it would just be great if we could do this one thing and like software can solve it. You know, and not everything, I'm not an absolutist by any means, but like software can solve it. And then you work on an interesting project and maybe it goes somewhere, maybe it doesn't, but you get that real experience, which is really what we're all after in this pursuit, right?
Yeah, I was just going to jump in about, say, the question in the chat is like, I totally agree with Judson's point about Upwork and what was the other one? We didn't say Upwork, but that's what I thought of.
Yeah, Fiverr, Upwork, yeah.
Fiverr, yeah. Like those things, on both sides of the market there, like in those platforms, like I've kind of come to the conclusion that they seem like a race to the bottom in many cases, right? Someone who's going to like find the cheapest bidder on a project also is maybe not the type of contract job that you want. Like that may not be the type of person that you want to be working with. And then also exactly, it's a global market. It's highly saturated. People will do work for free. But like actually that first contract gig that I mentioned, this is public knowledge, so I can share it. But the first guy that he hired was someone in India who he found on, I think it was Upwork. And the guy actually ripped off his idea and submitted it to the Shopify app store. And Shopify didn't do anything about it because he's in a different country. And there was no NDA, there was nothing that could be enforced. And that like really, you know, that put a sour taste in his mouth for those platforms. But I would say, yeah, the more like the more unique and creative you can get with where you kind of like source leads from is the best. So I would say that was the first contract gig that I had. And that was the only one I kind of got sort of blind. The four or five that followed were all through my network in different places. Like there were two through Turing, people that I met at Turing. There were like, I used to be involved with like music when I was a kid, and one was like a music thing, like a marching band, kind of like youth music thing that a friend was working on. And yeah, it was just sort of like word of mouth. And I had a friend, you were talking about local businesses. This is the last part of my ramble here, is local businesses, especially like brick and mortar businesses. Like, you know, I live in Chicago and there are all these really great local restaurants that like don't even have a website, right? Or if they have a website, it doesn't have SSL, like it doesn't have HTTPS, right? So like it doesn't get ranked on Google now. And like I knew a guy here who just made a list of like five, I think it was like 5 or 10 different businesses that were popular, and basically went to these businesses and just pitched them on like making their website for him, which for like, especially for front-end people, that's such a great thing. Because then you can just build them a website with what they want, work out the details, if it has, you know, functionality like store stuff or anything, reservations. And then you can host it on like Vercel or Netlify or something with SSL, and you can manage that for them. And I think this dude made like 1500 or two grand a pop, and he did it with like five different groups, and it was like part of his little side hustle. So there's definitely opportunities there, and I totally agree that like the more creative you can get with where you find these areas, the better it's going to be, for sure.
Awesome. I love it. I think like Judson, you were like, sorry, I didn't answer your question. You absolutely did. I think, you know, sometimes even when we're talking about like jobs that are not in the contract workspace, like applying for dev roles, I think sometimes it can feel easier or less vulnerable to just go to these websites and just apply blind. And we're finding, I think you definitely like cemented this for contract work, and we're finding it for full-time dev roles, which is that the network is really where you see the needle get moved, right? It's not going to be a blind application, most likely. It's probably going to be somebody in your network. So the fact that that's mirrored in this space, I think is great. And I can definitely say, like, one of my buddies, like, a year ago started a business. He was talking about how he was going to make his website on Squarespace. And I was like, can I make it? Like, can I do it instead? And he was like, sure. And I did it. And I didn't charge him anything because I wanted to support him and his business. But I now have, there's a website out there that is used, like, by real people that I built, and I get to talk about that. And so, yeah, I just, like, really echo everything that y'all have said so far, which is great. Okay, let's talk money. So how do we know how much to charge? This is a question that people get. I am going to share in the chat, and this is a bookmark that is in the New Grad Services Slack channel. So in the New Grad Services Slack channel, there's a bookmark at the top that points to this doc. I don't know who put this doc together, but it looks like folks from Turing have shared their hourly charges. How did y'all, Dan and Judson, how did you decide what to charge? Like, what, how do you even decide on a number?
Agonizingly, after a long period of, like, trying to be like, am I charging too much? Are they going to laugh in my face? Are they going to tell me no? Like, so for me, my first experience was this, you know, this one big project where I actually, you know, we didn't do an hourly rate. We did a total, like, per, you know, whatever, and definitely ended up underselling it for sure. Although, you know, it's led to so many things, like, I don't regret it at all, but, like, you know, they wanted a custom web app, blah, 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 as mentioned before, back end, front end hosting, like, and Dan made a really good point earlier, just to call out again, like, you know, you're going to be responsible for all of that if you take on these smaller gigs. And so just being ready for that. You know, did kind of like a lump sum there, and that was $20,000, just to be super transparent, and probably should have charged about 45, I think, or so. But anyway, so yeah, like, there's some data out there. You can kind of look around and Google around and get some sense of it or whatever. But to be honest, to me, it's a sliding scale. Like, you probably should not charge a ton early up front just to, like, land the things, or even do it for free and, like, say you charged if you're talking to other people, so it doesn't sound like you did a favor for a friend or whatever. Like, you can do those things, right? When you're talking about your resume and you're talking in interviews and stuff like that. But yeah, like, you know, the best arc to me is similar to what you were saying, Kayla. You do something for a friend, it's live, people are using it, and then you start to kind of get a good sense of it. And then, you know, you maybe track down another couple people in your network and you cut them a friendship deal or whatever, and kind of just work your way up. But, you know, it's tough to know what the market will bear, right? And I will say, though, one of the things that I've realized over the last 5 years or so is, like, people in general, like, if you give them a number, are most likely not going to, like, laugh at you, right? And so, like, they're going to have, most people are willing to have a conversation, right? They'll be like, well, that's not what I was expecting to pay, or whatever the case may be, right? And so you will probably undercut yourself at some point. Like, you know, you'll charge 20 for a project that should have been 45 and whatever, but that's just part of the learning thing. So I don't know that there's like a good static way I could tell you, like, oh, this is what you should charge. But I mean, that document, I mean, lays it out pretty well, right? Like, somewhere in the $25 to $50 an hour, like, dollar an hour range, like, for your very first ones. But you typically want to, when you get settled in it, and if you make contracting your thing, you typically want to think about, what do I want to make W-2 wise, and let me just double that hourly rate, right? And so you kind of do that whole, like, I'm going to try to make $100,000 W-2. That's equivalent around of $50 an hour. So let me charge 75 or even 100. So, I mean, in the interest of transparency, I haven't added to that doc, but I will after this. But I charge 100 an hour for, like, my existing relationships, and then 200 an hour for anything new. So just to give you all one data point, you know.
Yeah, that's all those points were, like, super spot on. With the actual, like, charging of clients, I've gone in different directions, and it was a lot of trial and error. But the simplest answer is just, like, think about what you would want to make on a W-2 like job. And one of the best ways to do it, if you really want to keep it simple, is just and this also works if during negotiations anyone wants to, like, challenge your how you decided to pay yourself, like, why you're charging what you do. And you can even bring this up in discussions, and it's a very reasonable thing, like, at least 150% of what you could get at a, you know, normal job, right? So if it's $100,000, like, at least 150K, and then divide that into an hourly rate, and then that's your hourly rate, like, to start, right? Because, like, if you do make contracting your thing, just like Judson was saying, like, you know, you're not, you have to take care of taxes, your own benefits, health insurance, all this stuff, right? And so at least 150%. And so I think like when I first started, I did something where like I was doing it by the hour, which I got way far away from towards the end. Like that was actually, it turned out to be a huge mistake, which I like would do not recommend for project-based work. If you're just going to be like a developer for a company and they're like, hey, we'll have this for you to do, this for you to do, cool, fine, like agree on the hours. But if it's like a project, I would say doing the project estimate. And that's because, like I said, you're a big cost center for a lot of these businesses, depending on what the business is. So I think when I started, I like did like an introductory hourly rate of like half of my normal rate for like 30 days or 60 days to see if they would be like into my work. It's kind of like we both have skin in the game type of thing. And then I think then it was like 60 an hour. And then I think the last contract gig I did was I charged it for the whole project and they paid me 50% upfront and 50% when it was done. And that was all written out in invoices, which I highly recommend. Like they're free invoice systems like Zoho and stuff. There, I think the last rate was like 180 an hour, but I figured out the exact, it was some, I spent a lot of time trying to figure out, spec out the work and then get a total hours estimate. And then I bumped it up by about 20% because you just, things always take longer. If you're not like, if you're interning, you totally know that things will just take longer. And then even with that, I was still scrambling to get it done. Right. And so that was like 180 an hour, but I did it in one lump sum. They paid half of it and then they paid the rest when I was done. I will say just on this point, if we want to talk about money more, the type of client that you get that will agree to like a $10,000 contract sometimes may be a little bit easier to work with than the client that might hassle you over $500, right? Or $600. And so like, I definitely learned this the hard way with two clients in particular about estimates for things. Like we didn't have the full information, things took longer. And then they, you know, there was at least one point where they didn't want to pay what we had agreed. And it was for a sum of like $500 or $600. And that was for like a very small bootstrap startup. And that was a very big concern to them. And then one of the latter clients that I worked with was a private law firm, and they had no problem, you know, writing a $10,000 check. And so it's like thinking about what are the business pressures from their side, you know, can really help you like come into negotiations, but also like set yourself up for success and not have to deal with a lot of hassle. So.
Awesome. Thank you. Prior to going to Turing, I was like you, Dan, I was a teacher. And so I'm hearing all of this stuff and I'm getting a little overwhelmed by like taxes and like W-2s and maybe those are the same thing. Like, I don't know anything. Right. And so I have questions around like, how did you two, and I know Judson, you had mentioned that you've had experience with contract work and that helped you a lot. I'm wondering, like, Dan, for you, what was that learning curve like of learning like the logistical side of things? And who did you have someone that you were going to for advice? Like, how did you figure that side of things out? Because to me, that is the more intimidating part than the code.
Yeah, totally. So that was also like learning along the way. I think that I went to like back in like 2017, I went to like a Boulder Startup Week thing. I used to live in Broomfield. Now I'm in Chicago, but I went to this Boulder Startup Week thing and it was like by a law firm that specialized in startup law. And it was about like what you should do to like protect yourself in terms of liability and then also taxes. And basically when I started, I did a lot of like reading about stuff on the internet, which you can only do so well. And then I did do like a free consultation with this law firm in Boulder and just talked to them about what I was going to do. And they were like, okay, you don't need to like hire us. You just need to like cover these bases, right? And Judson probably knows a lot more about this, but like with my path, I just try to keep it as simple as possible from when I started. And when I started, I just filed all that income on my normal taxes, like as an individual. So I was a sole proprietorship, which is like if you make money on the side of anything, you are like the government designates you as like a sole proprietor of a business, right? And then I learned down the road that like things could be easier. That also means I didn't like have any business expenses. I didn't deduct any expenses. Like I used my personal computer. I didn't like deduct the internet cost or anything like that. No expenses. I just paid taxes on like the actual income. Like I would pay taxes on income from, or like a job would take out, right? With like a 9-to-5 W-2 job. You know, I might have done something wrong at that time. I didn't get audited. So if I did, I don't know. I tried to do my best. And what I found with taxes, especially like state taxes, this was an interesting thing in Colorado, is that if you do something, and this is not legal advice or any type of advice, like don't take my word for this, but just in my experience, is that if you do mess up, or if you did something wrong, as long as you've been trying to pay your taxes and do the right thing, the state or whoever will contact you. And if you settle it, like you figure it out, it's no big deal. Like one time I didn't know that I needed to pay sales tax on something. And the state of Colorado contacted me. And cause I got like an, I got a 1099 from one of my contracts. And I like, I don't even remember the details. It was like 2018, I think, 2019 maybe. And we worked it out, so it was fine. Down the road, I did learn more about liability from like a legal perspective. And that's when I did get an LLC, which I used a registered agent for, which was all new to me also. And I did a single member LLC. A registered agent is a company that will register the LLC for you with the government, and then they will take care of all the paperwork to keep it up to date, because you have to file with the Secretary of State every year. And having an LLC, there's debate about this, but I've come to understand it does offer some kind of legal protection if you were to get sued for doing something like this, right? And I've never been sued in this industry, thankfully, knock on wood. When you are deploying people's software with their sensitive customer data, and if you do something like, hey, I forgot to secure a database, or I set up the server wrong, and there was like something happened, which is really easy to do, especially if you ever do infrastructure stuff, you know, you might be liable for it if it costs damages to the company. So the LLC I got out of that concern. And when you use a registered agent, you have to put a physical address with the Secretary of State when you register a business in most states. And that's definitely the case in Colorado. So when you use a registered agent, you don't have to use your home address, and you can use the registered agent's address, which is just nice because then you don't get all sorts of spam. And that's when I also got business insurance, like liability insurance. And that was about $60 a month. I used Hiscox, and you can get like certain type of liability for liability insurance for digital stuff, right? For like cyber stuff. Like if you get hacked and it's not your fault, but it still messes up your customers or like your contracts customers, you might still be liable, right? I've thankfully never had to use it, but I did have it, and it did give me a small peace of mind. That's kind of as far as I took it in this way. But as far as taxes, I just tried to do everything I could. I paid it as income, and I just tried to keep it simple. So.
Yeah, I mean, we could probably have, you know, 2 hours of conversation about all the different pieces that make up this stuff. But I think in general that, you know, if you're going to do this, even if you're doing it for a friend or just kind of as a one-off, having an LLC is $50 in Colorado, fairly cheap in most states. I think I've registered LLCs in Colorado, Delaware, and Louisiana, and they've all been under $100. You know, what does LLC stand for? Limited liability company. So you get some protection there. The biggest thing you want to do whenever that, you know, just call out here that when you have an LLC is you don't want to, what they call, pierce the corporate veil. And so you don't want to mix your money, right? And so you should have the LLC, you know, basically receive whatever income you're receiving, you know, in its name. You can get a business bank account. They're typically free. I've had one with Chase. I've had one with Capital One. Currently, I have one with a company called Novo, which is a kind of like online only, like API driven kind of bank, which is interesting. They're, like I said, free, never had to pay for them or anything like that. And so you can get those there, and then you can basically do these disbursements out to yourself. And you know, the taxes are still equivalent of you basically making that money directly, but to be very clear, like when you make money on a 1099, you are responsible for the employer's portion of FICA and Social Security as well. So you tend to want to think about it as like, when I get that $1,000 check in for the job that I did, you want to take anywhere from 30 to 38% of that and set it aside. To really do it right, you should be making quarterly tax payments because in some instances, depending on the income you get from your contracting, you can be required to have quarterly tax payments. Usually, I think the IRS is actually pretty lenient about that. If you make the payment in full at the end of the year, once they've calculated out what you owe or whatever, I've never had an issue with it, even though 1 year I was required. I have been in some sticky situations, and to Dan's point, like the IRS is super willing to talk it out with you, and like yeah, it may take you like 3 or 4 hours to get on the phone with them, but like all of the agents I've ever talked to have been super nice and super helpful, and like as long as you're like rational about it, you know, and you're not yelling and screaming, like they're gonna help you out. I actually owed, it was the year that they switched, like I was married, and so the year they switched kind of dual income to be like a different calculation. We just calculated it wrong. And so I had a decent amount of contracting income, and I think ended up owing $10,000 to the IRS, which is not a great position to be in. And so I ended up working out a payment plan. I think we paid it out over like a year or so after that. All right. And that was fine. There was no fees. It was just like, okay, great. Like we set it up. There's an online portal. Like I would just log in every month and make my payment. And like I said, our IRS is pretty, you know, pretty good about it. If like, to Dan's point, you're trying to make it right. It's interesting you said about the state one. My first company actually runs the tax system in the state of Colorado. So that was like letters that we set up and what you would have received. But anyway, so yeah, like we could talk a long time about all the pieces that go into this. I think the LLC makes a ton of sense. Realistically, at the end of the day, like I would just recommend, obviously depending on how much, right? You do one job and you get paid $500. It doesn't make sense to maybe go to a CPA or use like, you know, some type of platform you'll have to pay for, like QuickBooks Online has like a self-employed thing. But you know, if you make more than that or significantly more than that, like things like QuickBooks Online self-employed or even going to a CPA is going to cost you anywhere from $100 to $500, but you'll get a lot of peace of mind and maybe even find some of those business things that you can claim. So, you know, you can do things like claim a portion of your rent. You can claim a portion of your internet, your cell phone, depending on if you drive for that, you can claim some of that. So like, there are areas where you can lower your taxable income burden. And most years now that I don't have a lot of active projects, I actually lower my burden enough that I don't owe any taxes on any of my income from contracting because I'm able to claim so much that I'm able to lower that burden. So, you know, it's going to be worth it to go to an expert. And so I think that's a good idea. But, you know, like it's so easy to do the LLC. I would say even in the situations where it is just a friend or whatever, you may as well do it. And even if you don't get all the steps exactly right, like you'll still at least have some of that protection. And then when you go, if it ends up growing into something more, like you can always go to a CPA or somebody and have them help you, like, you know, finish it or correct it or whatever. If you really want to get serious with it, last thing I'll say is, there are things you can do like S corps and things like that, where there's a lot more tax savings, but that would be like, if I'm full-time contracting is my only thing and I've got, you know, the money to spend on a lawyer to get things set up correctly, and I've got the $5,000 or so I'm going to need to get everything set up and all that. So if you're ever in that position, feel free to reach out. I'll be happy to like help out with that. But, you know, from a baseline, I think the LLC is a good idea. And then, you know, just spend a little bit of extra money if you have it to get somebody to look over your taxes or even file them for you.
Yeah, I forgot about the bank account point, but that's absolutely. I completely agree. Like if you look up and read about piercing the corporate veil, like the more you separate it and don't treat it as like an intermingling of your own finances, the less likely that they'll be able to go after your personal assets if anything does happen. Hopefully it doesn't. But like you want to just pretend that like the worst possible case could happen in some cases. But exactly like Justin said, like if it's $500 for a friend, like you can just put that on your personal taxes and like figure it out. But like if it's a significant amount of money, you definitely like an LLC is very easy. Getting a bank account, there are services that can help you with this and just keep it separate. You know, I used to just keep all my contracting money in the business account and then I would pay myself from that. And then that would be the taxable event also and pay taxes like from what I had there. And There's a question in the chat too about contracts. I'd say like it's kind of a similar line about like if it's something that's a significant amount of money or you're worried about liability, like it's sensitive data or something like medical data or your or legal information, then I would, you know, you can get a lawyer to look at something for like $500, right? And it can be worth it for the peace of mind. With contracts, I've always basically used the invoices as contracts, where I would do extremely detailed work, and I would say, and I would use email to track correspondence and say, like, we've agreed to this work, and I would try to be as detailed as possible. I had a friend who's a lawyer look at it, and she does contract law, and she, like, it was very brief, and she was like, that's, for most cases, if it's written down, there's an agreement. This varies by state, unfortunately, like, in terms of, like, enforceability, but like I've said, I've never had an issue with this. And these companies don't want issues either. It's going to cost them money to go after you. Like you'd have to really cause some damage for things to happen. So, getting things in writing, definitely important, using invoices to talk about detailed work that you've done and what was agreed to on what date, I definitely think is always a good move. Having a lawyer look at every nook and cranny for like an $1,800 contract maybe is not worth your time.
Right. Well, yeah, one more piece there. Like I use contracts for everything. So I've never done the invoice route. And I just from me, that was from my history in like construction and other industries where, you know, I had to go to court for a few of those things and file mechanics liens and various other pieces. And so having that like single document along with all the other pieces of everything that I've submitted, including invoices, was very comforting for me and like a good, and you can just use a template. And to Dan's point, like depending on the amount of the contract, have a lawyer review it or not. I mean, like some of them are written in such a way where like you can grok it, like, you know, just take you a little time, but it's not like it's speaking a foreign language. And it's talking about if you breach a contract in these five ways, then you owe this thing or whatever the case may be. So you shouldn't definitely not be afraid to like review stuff yourself for like $1,000 contract. But I mean, even for small, not friend stuff, I will say, but like for small stuff for people I don't know, I would still put together a quick contract that just laid out at least the initial expectations.
Awesome. Cool. That was really helpful and super informative and like kind of turn into a nice little advertisement for the IRS. Like, oh, they're so nice if you just talk to them.
They are actually really, really nice. Yes, they are actually really nice. It's surprising, but yes.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Like everybody is in a bad mood when they call, you know what I mean?
Right. So, yes. And if you're not, they're like, hell yes, I love this person. Let me help them as much as I can. Because if you're just like, hey, I'm just like, cute, like I just need some help or whatever, they love it. They love it.
Yeah, so that's awesome. Yeah. Cool. I'm going to close this out with one more question. And so I think maybe another fear of contract work, and this has been mentioned a couple of times, is like you're doing all of it by yourself, or in a lot of times you're doing it alone. And so who do you two go for or go to when you have questions about the technical side of things? Like you're kind of maybe outside of your realm of understanding. How are you finding technical support when you're working on contract work alone?
The skills of Googling that I got at Turing. I mean, to be honest, like I would not necessarily recommend this especially if you have like pretty serious contracts or like a, you know, just tight deadline or like, you know, for sure you've got an entire community at Turing. Like I'm in the question channel, personally, I'm in the question channel and all those places like constantly. Like I'm always happy to hop on with people and walk through complicated workflows and things like that. So like you should take advantage of that. But you know, in the more laid back ones potentially, right? Like you should take the exact same skills you learned at Turing and go figure it out on your own, you know? And like, there's a ton of documentation out there about database backups and infrastructure and like HTTPS and what is an SSL cert and like, how do I get one and blah, 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 like how do I install it? Like all of that has stuff out there. Now, you know, again, this is always a sliding scale. Like it always depends, right? Like if it's a serious thing, like, and you have a deadline, like please reach out to someone, you know, in Turing or whoever, like there's literally hundreds of years of experience floating around in that Slack. So, you know, take advantage of it. But yeah, for me, it was a lot of just Googling and a lot of like making some mistakes, luckily not any serious mistakes, you know, always set up a staging environment, always worked with non-prod data whenever I could, like type of thing, but like, just a lot of like, you know, doing it on my own, but like, you know, main point would be, I guess I show ChatGPT in there nowadays too, you know, right? Like use all your resources, right? And so if you have those resources, you should utilize them now.
I totally agree. I mean, I, you know, with most of the stuff that we do, like in this industry, like if you take long enough on your own, you can figure it out, right? If you search hard enough and look long enough and try to understand things, you can figure it out. But exactly like Judson was saying, like if you're on a deadline and you've agreed to a deadline and there's money attached to that, like then absolutely reach out for help to actual people who know what's going on. And this could be as simple as like, I've reached out for help like on Twitter, you know, or like on like just to like a random group for certain things. But most of the stuff, like after enough time with it, like I was able to figure out on my own. And it was like new stuff in certain ways. And so there's the two sides to that too, is like you have a lot of new stuff that you're gonna be responsible for. But the benefit of that is like, you get a shitload of experience like really quickly, right? Especially when you're wearing all the hats, right? So like in a company, you may just write JavaScript and tests and that's it. And someone else deals with everything else, but like you're doing everything. And so if that can be exciting for some people, or like, you know, anxiety inducing also, and it's a sliding scale for sure. So, you know, and like, depending on like, you should know the type of work, it's all within an arena. Like if you're gonna take a job and say that you can do the job and it's in Rails, or even if it's in a related thing, like, you know, close enough, like Python or whatever, like you should feel pretty confident coming out of Turing that you can figure out most of those things, right? If you take a job where you're like writing, you know, a compiler for x86 architecture, and you say you can do it for $100,000 or something, like that, like you got to think about the sort of arena that you're going to be struggling in. So, you know, Turing actually does a pretty good job of like preparing people for that kind of struggle and exploration. So it can totally be done, you know.
Awesome. Thank you both so much. I do like to end by just leaving space if Dan or Judson, you have anything that you wanted to share that my questions haven't pointed you in that direction. Is there anything left that y'all wanted to say?
Take advantage of the resources. You know, like I said, I mean, you know, I'm 100% always open personally for questions and things like that. So very easy to find. Hit me up on Slack. I can give you an email if you're, you know, more comfortable with that. Actually, I'll just drop my email in the chat real fast. But you know, always open to that, those conversations. And, you know, that, like I said, there's lots and lots of experience out there. There's no reason to go it alone. And so like, just reach out and ask, you know?
Yeah. Same. I'll drop my email here too. Thanks. Thanks for having us. I would say that there was the biggest like kind of silver lining, like making extra money was fun and everything, getting the experience, was great. But one thing that I didn't quite anticipate that actually was quite a helpful to me doing a lot of this work, because I came from teaching too. I'm like not from a business background as much. And being able to like advocate for yourself and in fact, like things like negotiating and being comfortable in difficult discussions with other stakeholders. I would say that like my contracting work gave me it gave me so much more confidence in that realm than I had even anticipated. So like when I work for a startup now, and when I went into the negotiations for the job, for salary and stuff, it's like I directly drew on that experience of talking with business owners and trying to negotiate a contract to do work for them. And so it gives you more of an insight into the what the business constraints are, what other parties see themselves, like what are pressure points for them. And it gives you kind of like a lot of good negotiation chops. And I would say for me, that was actually one of the most, you know, sort of like valuable experiences that I had with it. So something else to consider. So.
Awesome. Thank you all so much. Thanks for coming, everybody. And like I said, I'll share this recording as soon as it finishes downloading on my computer, which usually takes like 25 minutes. All right. I'll see you all later. Bye, everybody.
Yeah.